This is a very novel idea that all the participants are also asked to present the way of teaching of this course in a workshop like this. In fact, we are in a phase of changing the syllabus in the coming board of studies of our department. So I will be presenting whatever we are teaching since last 3 years to our students. 3 years ago, we used to teach computer programming course using Fortran. So as sir said, Fortran had almost become obsolete and people wanted change. So that time we decided that why not directly change the programming course in which the students learn programming through Java. Now that time the idea was because all the classes that the students would write would basically be containing some procedures. So students would understand procedural procedures as well as object orientation. Since this course is offered to students of all the branches, may it be computer, may it be civil, may it be electrical or mechanical. So the course was designed like this. The syllabus is displayed here, and the books that were recommended were fundamental books, maybe by one of the good books on this is by Grady Booch, which tells about good object oriented programming concepts. So this is the syllabus that we are currently following, and the feedback that we got in these 3 years is that the students belonging to other branches are not able to grasp the programming concepts well, because they are all the time getting confused between object orientation and procedural paradigm. So now we are in a phase of again coming back to the procedural paradigm of programming. So we are thinking that we'll again make this basic course of computer programming in which the students will learn programming through C. In our teaching schedule, we usually have 4 hours of theory classes per week, and for each batch we have 2 hours for lab. One tutorial is kept sometimes when students demand for that. So it's not, because it is not included in the scheme, that's why I have not mentioned it here, but 4 hours per week theory lectures and 2 hours of lab per batch is for sure. The batch size is 30 students per batch, and in our labs also we have 30 systems for students, so 1 student per machine. For evaluation, we keep 2 in semester tests. Usually the semester is of 14 weeks duration, so after first 4 weeks we keep first test. After next 4 weeks we keep another test, and then we have a small quiz before end, and then we have a final examination. In labs, the lab instructors along with the teachers continuously evaluate the programs which are written by the students. These programs correspond to the lab assignments that are given to them. At the end, they conduct some Viva Voce exam, and this Viva Voce is generally one during the semester and one at the end of the semester, and the marking is done after considering performance of the students in all these. These are some sample assignments that I got. Some are very primitive kind of programs, some are a bit better, and when Java was, Java has been rather a programming language of use in lab for last 3 years. So there are some questions like this also, in which we give some kind of scenario and ask the students to identify various classes and objects so that the teacher is able to ensure whether the student is understanding the problem or not for solving. So these are some sample questions. Lab resources, as I mentioned, we have more machines in lab than there are students per batch. We have Linux operating system, Java 1.5. In one lab, we have diskless machines in which students work. We have two servers. Windows servers is used by some other students. We have certain licensed softwares also, but they are not required in this computer programming course. As sir said that day, I have also tried to include some financial aspects, though they are just, I think, indicative kind of, and these are not the final figures for the course that we will be conducting in July. TA to experts, as was mentioned in the ISTE guideline, for 2 weeks was only 42,000, but I think that is probably by mistake, because it was given for 1 week, 2 week, 3 week and 4 week courses. It was all same for all years. So for 2 weeks, I think it will be more. And for these days, I think giving honorarium only for 250 rupees per week, per hour to an expert will be very little. So I have calculated the figure by just making this amount double, that is 500 rupees per hour, so that it looks a bit respectable. For local experts also, the remuneration would be 400 rupees per hour, and for lab, it will be again double of what was mentioned, that is 200 rupees per hour per person in the lab. Honorarium to course coordinator, I don't know, it's okay. Ancillary staff also will demand more money, as we discussed earlier. Publications, okay, contingency probably will require more money. So my guess is that it will come around a figure which is rupees 2 lakhs. So I think 2 lakh rupees should be okay to run a course of 2 weeks. If we don't include participants from outside our city, so that we are not required to give them any kind of TA, DA, etc. We will just offer them lunch and tea twice a day.
So
it's only boarding charges.
I would love to
learn. No, it's lodging charges. It's not boarding, because they'll just be there. It's boarding charges. Yeah. So in coming next week, we have a board of studies meeting, and we are planning to change our syllabus such that the computer programming will not be taught through object-oriented paradigm, but through procedural paradigm, and we want to revert back to C, looking to the results that the students are giving to us. Even our training and placement officer has given this feedback to us, that you please change your syllabus of computer programming, because students are not understanding programming well, and they are not performing well in interviews.
I am tempted to comment at this stage itself, because computer programming has been a subject very close to my heart. That was the first time I taught that subject was in 1972. And like she said, we were also using Fortran programming as the programming language to be used. Object-oriented programming per se is not necessarily wrong. The point is, at which point in time in the course do you introduce the notion of object-oriented programming? Because whether you want to teach object-oriented programming or even functional programming, the fundamental programming is still perceived as procedural concept being very well known and ground. Traditionally, most of us have learned object-oriented programming or functional programming subsequent to having mastered procedural program. Whether procedural programming is a must as a fundamental background is a debatable question. For example, those who insist that procedural programming must be taught, you take the same logic backwards. In the early days, when the compilers were just coming in, programming in machine language was considered most important. Understanding of the computer architecture, hardware, ALU, the execution sequence of instructions, program counters, these were considered absolutely fundamental to any programming effort. They were necessarily taught as an initial part of any programming course. You go back to 70s. No, I don't think you were teaching programming in 1971, so you won't know.
But my teachers who have been your students have passed on that kind of sanskars to us. So
That's a dilemma that we have, because we don't necessarily quickly shift our mind to new environment. But today it is very well acknowledged that teaching hardware concepts to students of a course who are primarily going to learn higher level language, a programming language, is positively detrimental to the understanding, proper understanding of the programming concepts at the higher level. So these are some of the things that we have to keep in mind. But anyway, it was a good, can you just go back to
the previous slide? Basically, what she is concluding that from the internal cost points of view, she believes that 1,78,000 rupees should be good enough to conduct a 2-week program, provided you don't have to arrange for accommodation, stay and dinner, breakfast, etc. for the participants. If the participants are in the same city, can you tell me if you have to accommodate such students at extra cost, let's say, at your place like Indore, what would be such typical cost per day for if you have to arrange them in your hostel or guest house or something, and what is the food bill per day, etc. So what would be the approximate cost per participant sort of per day? Or
in our guest house, I think it should be 600 rupees a day, that's what I think. But I'll have to find out the exact figure.
So 600 rupees a day for stay and food. So if you multiply that by 15, you're talking about 9,000 rupees for 2 weeks. Are you sure it's 600 rupees? Because even in IIT, it is not 600 rupees. So Indore is costlier than Mumbai, I'm happy to note, but you do not. Okay, so that is something that you should find out. I will request all participants to go back and find that out. Because as we said last time, we will probably figure out a way by which the participating teachers or their institutions should be willing to pay. If the remote center is not in their own town, then they should be able to pay this as a sponsorship charges to the institution which is conducting this program. And we would like it to peg it at a realistic level.
Sir, I also want to share one thing. This is regarding the kind of teachers we have in our colleges. The regular teachers, the number of regular teachers who have some amount of experience are reducing in number, and new teachers with very less experience and from colleges where there were no teachers for them also is increasing. So that actually the person who is coordinating this course of computer programming in first year, actually this is not working, he is coordinating this subject of computer programming, and he is going to IIT Delhi for PhD in software engineering. So he is more inclined towards software engineering rather than computer programming. So that's why this kind of bias.
Did I share with you the famous Bhagavat law, which is very well known in IIT? Did I mention it in any of the classes?
No.
There was a Professor Bhagavat was head of the electrical engineering department, and there was a huge debate on the syllabus and the nomenclature of the subject and so on in one of the faculty meetings. My guide, Professor Kekre, was a teacher then. I was still a M.Tech student, so he's a second-hand information. So, this happened later when I was a teacher in the computer center. In one of the faculty meetings, Professor Bhagavat observed that it does not matter what syllabus you define or what name you give to the topic, because a teacher ultimately teaches what he knows. So, in fact, Kekre objected strongly, and he said, "Sir, how can you say that?" So, Professor Bhagavat asked Kekre, Do you mean to say you teach what you don't know? That was hard. So this is the Bhagavad law, and there is a Kekre corollary which says that a conscientious teacher learns the new subject and syllabus and then teaches it, because nobody can teach without knowing it. So this is one example. Okay, fine. Just go to the previous slide where you are showing some sample questions. So these assignments are actually lab assignments, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. What I wanted to also know is, from your experience, by just quantitative measure, what is the total number of programs that students actually write, and what is the size of the largest program in terms of simply LOC, number lines of code, approximately, I mean.
Number of programs that they write is around 50 to 60, this is what I guess.
Okay.
And maximum length, I think, should be somewhere between 50 to 70 lines of code.
Okay. That is one bother I have, that every student doing this course, we have the notion of a course project, by the way. That project is given to the students somewhere around middle of the semester after doing some assignments, and they will have to develop that entire code on their own. It is not uncommon to find that students here write anywhere between 250 lines to 1000 lines of code as a part of that course. And that is where the maximum learning actually happens. Because if you are teaching programming, then number of programs written, I would be concerned if the number of programs is being maximized rather than the quality of programming and the, should I say, complexity of programming. But anyway, that is the practice that you have. How do they end up writing 50 to 60 programs? Because that is, in the labs there are various... Find out the maximum of three numbers. Yeah. Correct. Okay. The second question I have is that what are the marks allocation? Suppose there are 100 or 200 marks for the totality. How are the marks allocated to different parts of the evaluation?
Generally, the lab assignments are P in number. And for completion of every lab assignment, certain marks are awarded. For example, when the preliminary questions are given in lab assignment 1, there is one mark per question if there are 10 number of questions.
I see. But total evaluation of lab amounts to what percentage of marks in their complete course in the subject? So how many marks for the lab and how many marks for the in-semester exams and how many marks for the end-semester exam? This is something you may want to find out later and supply. Yeah. Or if you recall...
Remember certain
Haan,
theory exam carries 100 marks, which is end semester exam, and two mid semester tests and quiz actually are taken for award of classwork marks. Then for last classwork marks are 50.
50.
So this 50 are awarded out of two mid sem plus one quiz.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then there is sessional marks award, which is based on submission of lab assignments and the Viva Voce exams that are conducted one during the semester and at the end of the semester.
Lab plus Viva. And how many marks for this? Sessional?
50.
So classwork 50, sessional 50 and theory 100. And when you say theory, that's a very funny nomenclature, because I don't think you are teaching theory of either programming languages or theory of programming to them. You are teaching them very fundamental concepts of programming. So, do you remember any pattern of the questions which are asked in the final exam? If I recall correctly from my Indore days, I also studied in that college, by the way, that's my alma mater. A paper would be question 1A, describe something, something. Question 1B, some problem. Question 2A, okay, discuss this or whatever. Question 2B, some problem. So, typically, 50% of the paper more or less would be descriptive,
yes.
And 50% would be, that still happens.
I see.
So 50 to 50 is a good ratio. That's a major departure, incidentally, because in IIT, in a programming course or most courses of this time, there is nothing like describe, discuss something, only problems, and you have solved those problems. There's a very fundamental difference in the approach. But as I said, we have to make something useful to those students. So if our material only has problems and no description, well, that will not be well. So one request is, when you go back, get some papers and ask those people who evaluate those papers to write down some model answers for some of them. So we will know what kind of answers fetch students' marks. That is their ultimate interest in the life.
Sir, one copy I have.
Oh, you have. So we can share that with us. Okay. Any other question that colleagues would like to raise? Yeah, please. Just use the mic.
I'm not an expert in the field of programming, but I have general observations to make. And you have mentioned the character reform. Are you talking about changing the syllabi or curriculum? How do you distinguish these two?
There are two things. One is scheme, and another, the scheme defines the courses that the students will take, and syllabus defines, syllabus corresponds to one particular course, which says what the student will study in this particular course. So there are two things. One is scheme, and another is syllabus.
Rules and regulations for the particular course, they are different. Curriculum, we mean, to my mind, when you frame a syllabi, syllabus of a particular course, and you also add some kind of pedagogical components in it, tutorials, compensatory classes, and what kind of methodology you want to adopt. And if you integrate these two, that becomes a curriculum. So curriculum reforms means that part of it. One thing which I found in your presentation, that you presented the syllabus of that particular course. But the objectives of that course, why do you want to teach this?
I must answer this. We had arranged for this presentation a very limited perspective of collecting ground level information only. So this is not supposed to be a discussion either on pedagogy or on curriculum. Although I extended my brief when I started raising those questions. So here the purpose is to just find that out, and we shall have a separate session, two sessions in fact, one on the pedagogy which we'll try to collectively define, and the other on actually what we wish to do in that 4-week program for teachers. So you'll have that there. Any other questions from the participants about anything that strikes them? How many teachers do you have? That you did not mention. What is the total class size?
Total class size is only 60 for one section. We have 5 sections per semester. We have total 10 sections. 5 sections are taught in semester A and 5 are taught in semester B, this course.
Per semester.
So basically
you require 5 plus 5, 10 teachers in a year.
Yes. Or 5 is sufficient, because these 5 will again teach in the next semester.
Rest of their life they keep teaching computer programming.
No. In fact, they are given more number of subjects, because the number of teachers are less. So one teacher is required to take at least half the subject which is different from this. So you will be given, say for example, one full computer programming plus half data structures, or plus half, one and half course is the load.
3 courses per semester.
Yeah.
Curiously, that is the load in IIT also. But how come we are much less loaded than your teachers are? So what is the assistance that they get? For example, who conducts the lab?
They themselves have to.
Same
teachers. And for the observation that most of us have is that here you have lot of support of PG students, and you have lot of support staff also, which doesn't happen at our place. So that actually loads the teacher with the correction work, assignment checking, and this kind of load is also there.
So 1.5 courses per semester is an average teacher's load. Specifically for this, one teacher teaches 60 students and conducts everything from lectures to lab.
Sir, this is only for first year. For second, third, fourth year. Yeah.
That's the kind of load that you have. And you don't have any technical staff in the labs?
We do have.
So do they not help with the conduct of the labs?
There is some little bit of
let me ask you this question. are these technical staff primarily people who maintain the hardware and the servers and other things? They are not well versed in programming.
No.
So they can't participate in answering questions of students or checking what they are
doing. No.
They are just providers of the technical infrastructure.
Yes.
And what is the lab duration?
2 hours. Sir, the other subject, the other half subject actually is also quite a bit load, because that class strength is more than 100. It's approximately 120. So again, checking assignments is, it becomes equal to one full subject.
So 2 subjects per semester.
Huh, it's almost that.
We are not really discussing teachers. Yeah. It's a point.
Yeah, it's, there is a point.
That the teachers are so much inundated with work. There are no time to think, and there are no time to experiment and do any innovative work on it. And that is where we hope that collectively we will be able to help.
Yes, and I am very happy that those young teachers, inexperienced teachers, will also get some good exposure in these programs through this pilot program.
The last question that I wanted to ask is, out of 14 weeks roughly that your semester is, how many actually lecture hours are conducted? Because 4 hours per week you are saying.
Minimum of 40, but it sometimes it's 52, sometimes it's 48, sometimes.
So 40
minimum are 40.
Let's say 40 to 50 sessions.
Can yeah.
Because 14 weeks will mean 56.
Yes.
Hours.
But sometimes there is a holiday. Yeah. Sometimes twice we have mid semester tests, so we cannot have classes during that time.
Thank you so much.